Hey, yo, from the Kingdom of Ohio, this is OCCULTURE, where we transmit conversations on esoteric art, science, and history at 528 hertz. I am your host, Ryan Peverly. Welcome to transmission number 26. Thank you for being here. Music critic, journalist, and author Joel Selvin is in the house. Joel and I are going to be chatting about the historic free concert thrown by the Rolling Stones at the Altamont Speedway in December 1969. Joel has called this rock and roll's darkest day, and I'm sure many others would agree. I'm also sure some people are probably like, Ryan, what the hell does this story have to do with the occult? And to that I say this, as with anything occult, if you get caught up with the story on the surface, you've missed the message completely. To be fair though, this has nothing at all to do with occult study or philosophy. There's no magic, there's no alchemy, there's nothing like that. But this story does have an interesting place in the annals of not just rock music, but also American culture. The Altamont concert is not a forgotten moment by any means, but I think it does merit some attention because of the time in which it took place and how the hippie movement was viewed afterward. You also may remember that this popped up very anecdotally in episode 22 when I was talking about the Star Wars conspiracy with Isaac Weishaupt. So that's why I thought it'd be cool to talk about this story. So let's turn our attention to the author of the book, Altamont, The Rolling Stones, The Hell's Angels, and the Inside Story of Rock's Darkest Day. That author, of course, is Joel Selvin. Joel is a San Francisco-based music critic and author best known for his weekly column in the San Francisco Chronicle, which ran from 1972 to 2009. In addition to his book on Altamont, Joel has penned several other books examining the cross-section of music and culture, including Summer of Love, the Inside Story of LSD, Rock and Roll, Free Love, and High Time in the Wild West, as well as Peppermint Twist, The Mob, The Music, and The Most Famous Dance Club of the 60s. Joel has also authored or co-authored biographies on some notable musicians, including Rock and Roll Hall of Famers Ricky Nelson and Sammy Hagar. But our focus here is the story surrounding a free concert held at the Altamont Speedway in Northern California in December 1969. The Rolling Stones headlined a bill any fan of rock music would love to have seen, but the day was marred by biker beatdowns, bad drugs, and the death of a young black man named Meredith Hunter. Whether you've heard the story before or not, I think you'll learn a little something from this. It's a fine chat with one of the premier chroniclers of the San Francisco music scene, and if you're into speculation and conspiracy theory, please do stay tuned for the outro. And enjoy.
Please allow me to introduce myself. I'm a man of wealth and taste. I've been around for a long, long year. Stole many a man's soul of faith. I was around when Jesus Christ had his moment of doubt and pain. Made damn sure the pilot washed his hands and sealed his fate. Pleased to meet you. Hope you guessed my name. Puzzling you with the nature of my game. Stuck around St. Petersburg when I saw it was a time for a change. Killed the Tsar and his ministers. Anastasia screamed in vain. I rode a tank, held a generous rank.
Joel Selvin, thanks for being here, man.
I'm thankful for your interest.
Absolutely, man. I stumbled across the book probably a couple months ago, and fun fact, it actually came up very briefly in another conversation I had with somebody else that was talking about George Lucas and just kind of a passing mention of his one shot that made this documentary. So kind of reignited my interest in the whole story.
And that is a interesting bit of a footnote to the whole thing. It was his first day on a professional film crew, and he really wanted to do it just because he had an experimental lens he wanted to try out. And it was finicky, and he and Walter Murch, who was also on his first day on future Oscar winner, sat up on the top of the hill and fiddled with this finicky lens all day, and then finally got a shot of the crowd leaving, which ends up being like the last shot in the movie. And yeah, it, the shot does have a kind of Star Wars feel that's quite different from the rest of the 16 millimeter shots that were being taken.
Yeah, it's a pretty eerie shot, too, when you really think about the whole thing. You
know, it's a nice little coda, yeah.
Like, isn't the moon in the background there? It's just a really
kind of... Yeah, to the moon.
Yeah, it's pretty...
Panned across these people going through the... stumbling out of the hill in the dark and pans up to the moon.
Yeah, man. Yeah, that's a pretty interesting shot for sure. So, you know, this is one of the more fascinating stories in the history of music, and I'm glad you chose to tell it in this sort of detail. Your previous work has touched on some of the darker, shadier sides of the music business, and this is definitely one of those types of stories too. But I am curious up front here as to why you chose this particular subject to write about.
Well, an author needs a story, and you get looking for stories. The Altamont story had been sitting around my desk and my feet pretty much since I went to work at the Chronicle in 1970, which was like a year after the Altamont. And in contemplating like future book projects, that just came up out of the pile, and I went, oh, what a great story. And the odd thing was that nobody had ever tackled it before. There's 100 better writers than me that could have gotten to it before I did, but it was lying on the ground. I picked it up and took it.
Yeah, I haven't seen any accounts of it in this detail. I've read bits and pieces about it, but nothing to this level of investigation. I'm sure maybe the original Rolling Stone coverage might rival it in terms of true investigative journalism, but the way that you dive into it in book form, I think obviously just trumps that. Before we get too much further into this, I want to lay some groundwork here and establish some of the key players involved in the event itself. Some names that might pop up that people may not be familiar with. So I just want to run through some names and then have you summarize their involvement with the Rolling Stones or the event itself or some of the other side pieces that may have been involved here. I'm going to start with Rock Scully.
Rock Scully was the manager of the Grateful Dead, and he's really where this whole story starts. He was stranded in London after being arrested at Heathrow Airport with a bunch of LSD pills, and wound up with Keith Richards at Keith's house smoking a bunch of California Sensimilla marijuana that Rock had brought in with the LSD that the customs officials hadn't found, and staying up all night getting high on this exotic pot. Rock was there to tell some London guys how to put on free concerts in the park, and he told Keith he could fix it for the Stones to play in Golden Gate Park in San Francisco. And that's sort of where it all began.
Okay. How about Ronnie Schneider? Who was he?
Ronnie Schneider was the nephew and accountant for the Rolling Stones manager, Alan Klein. And Klein was an unscrupulous businessman who had bottlenecked all the Rolling Stones' money, causing financial problems that made them have to go and tour America. And they hired Ronnie Schneider away from his uncle to run the tour for them.
Well, Klein was the next name on my list, so you kind of covered him there, too. How about Sam Cutler?
Sam Cutler was the road manager on that tour. It was his first time as a professional road manager. He'd sort of come out of the London music scene, but he'd only really been working in for a year or so. And he was the sort of the fulcrum between the Rolling Stones and the rest of America. He was the gatekeeper.
How about...
Sam, of course, is famous for having provided $500 worth of beer to the Hells Angels for the Altamont concert.
Right, right. How about John James, which I believe is a pseudonym, right?
Yes, his name was John Chase. He was probably a member of the Witness Protection Program. He was ingratiated himself with the Stones when they showed up in Los Angeles, telling them that he worked for Chrysler and he could provide them with cars. Now, he told Chrysler he worked for the Rolling Stones and he could get them an endorsement. The truth was he didn't work for either Chrysler or the Rolling Stones, yet he ended up in a kind of senior management position on the tour and was actually the person who signed the contract with the Speedway owner for the Altamont concert. But keep in mind, he had no legal connection to the Rolling Stones.
Yeah, he absolutely didn't, but it seems like he may have had some connection to some organized crime as well, right?
Seems to be organized crime, seems to be police officers. He was later found running some kind of scam where he played Santa Claus for some phony children's charity at the Carter White House. He ended up doing a lengthy stretch in federal penitentiary for mail fraud. Died, I think, about 2006.
Okay. How about the Maisels brothers?
David and Albert Maysles were the pioneer filmmakers behind the whole nonfiction film movement of the independent cinema in America in the late 60s, and they were brought in at the very last minute to film a concert documentary for the Rolling Stones, which became Gimme Shelter.
And I have a couple of names here, too, that I want to talk about later that might not play a role in the larger discussion here, but could you tell people who Melvin Belli was?
Melvin Belli was San Francisco's most flamboyant and publicity-conscious attorney at the time. He called himself the King of Torts. And he kind of bounced into this thing like about 3 days before the concert when one of the Maysles advance men contacted him and arranged for him to represent the Rolling Stones. Again, the Rolling Stones never met with him. And Belli just sort of, you know, was a bluff and aggressive attorney who, you know, served as the mouthpiece for the concert on Thursday and Friday before the show.
And the other name that I want to touch on later is Sonny Barger.
Sonny Barger was the founder of the Oakland Hells Angels chapter, really an esteemed and distinguished member of that, and of all the Hells Angels. Sonny's probably the most famous and the most important leader. He was on the stage that day and was pretty disgusted by the whole thing. He stepped to the foreground in the next night on San Francisco radio, where he got on the phone and just delivered a complete broadside against the Stones and defending the Hells Angels.
Yeah, he absolutely did. And there's some other stories about what happened afterwards with the Hells Angels and the Stones I'd like to talk about too, if you're up for it. But I do also want to tell people here now too that this was not just a Rolling Stones concert. There were a lot of players involved that people would be familiar with in the general music scene at the time that are now household names. You know, we're talking about people like the Grateful Dead, which were really involved in this show up through the whole production of it. Could you maybe just talk a little bit about what their involvement was?
Well, sure. Like I said, their manager, Rock Scully, planted the idea in Keith Richards' mind. So the Stones came up with the concept for the concert while they were staying in Los Angeles before the tour. They met with Rock, and Rock agreed to handle the logistics. So Altamont was really a Grateful Dead concert production. Rock's plan called for the Stones to appear in Golden Gate Park. He was going to take out permits with the city for a Jefferson Airplane Grateful Dead concert, and then announced the Rolling Stones as a surprise guest the day before. The Rolling Stones, who were doing this for publicity, took over at a certain point the negotiations with the city, which pretty much ruined any possibility for San Francisco granting a permit. And that's when the whole thing started to fall apart. The next morning, Jagger announced the concert at a press conference in New York. He didn't know where, somewhere outside San Francisco, but he knew it would be on December 6th. And that began this whole sort of unraveling of trying to find a place and trying to get it happening. It was all very last minute and calamitous.
That was actually a good segue into my next point. I wanted to talk about the venue itself. The Altamont Speedway was not the first choice. How did that play out? They were looking at Golden Gate Park, I believe. I think you already mentioned that. But what happened with that that made that fall through? And then why did they ultimately choose Altamont?
At the end of the tour, Cutler came out to San Francisco to work with Scully while the Stones stayed in Alabama doing some recording. Up until Tuesday, before the Saturday concert, there was no location. On Tuesday, somebody stumbled across the Sears Point Raceway, about 60 miles north of San Francisco, had parking for 100,000. It was sitting at the corner, at the intersection of two major highways. It had infrastructure, it had police, it had concessions, it had bathrooms. And they cut a deal with the on-site management and started building a stage and bringing in sound. The next morning, the corporation that owned the racetrack woke up and realized what had happened. That would be Filmways, Inc., and they did not believe the Rolling Stones when they said they were doing this for charity. They understood that they were making a movie, and they wanted a fee for the rental of the track, and they wanted a piece of the movie's distribution rights. They were in that business. It's a wholly reasonable negotiating position, but the Stones refused to negotiate. Meanwhile, a stage and sound system went in this, and it wasn't until Thursday afternoon, when the stalemate was broken, a phone call came into Melvin Belli's office from this guy, Dick Carter, who owned the Altamont Speedway. Now, the Altamont Speedway was 60 miles east of San Francisco, on the very edge of nowhere. right before you get to the Central Valley. And it was a derelict raceway. He'd owned it for about a year. The biggest crowd he'd ever had was 6,000 people for a demolition derby. And he was about out of business, and he was wanted to do this for the publicity. They had to dispatch somebody to look at it. So they picked up Rock Scully in a radio traffic helicopter with Michael Lang, who'd come out. Michael was the producer of Woodstock, which had happened like 3 or 4 months before and was very much in the public's imagination at that point. I'm not sure what he was doing there, but he and Scully got into a helicopter and flew over the Livermore Hills outside of the East Bay and swooped down over this derelict racetrack. And Rock looked out and he saw broken glass, oil stains, piles of wrecked cars from the demolition derbies, and he was thinking, what the? When he heard Michael Lang go, oh, this is perfect, we can do it here. Now it's Thursday around 4 o'clock in the afternoon. You've got a 12 noon Saturday concert, and at that point they struck the set up at Sears Point. They started helicoptering pieces of it over. They started bringing pieces of new sound systems over. They essentially patched together two different sound systems and built a stage overnight in the dark without flashlights.
Yeah, it was a crazy process in the few days leading up to it. I want to take a step back, though, and maybe paint a smaller cultural picture of what's going on in American music with rock and roll and with the Stones in particular. You know, this is a very pivotal time, I think, in rock and roll, and particularly with live shows and festivals. Like you mentioned, Woodstock was just a few months prior to this. And the Rolling Stones were really about to break through, just in terms of worldwide fame and what this tour would represent in hindsight. But at this point in 1969, these guys, despite their success to this point, were not making a lot of money. In fact, you mentioned that, you know, they were doing this for publicity. They needed some money, some quick cash, I guess. And in your book, you actually characterize them as pretty much broke, financially speaking. But this tour that led up to the show at Altamont was actually a major turning point in rock and roll, especially the live aspect of it. But what was it about their tour leading up to this specifically that made it such a groundbreaking or marquee event in the history of rock music?
Oh, man, there's so much. I mean, they were the first, that 1969 tour was the first rock band to take their own stage, their own sound, and their own lighting. They were the first people to break the $5 concert ticket price. They booked halls that had never played rock shows before. They had to clear a hockey match out of the Los Angeles arena that afternoon to put two shows on that night. But what your question also hints at much larger changes that were going on in the entire history of rock. And at the end of 1969, it was reaching this tremendous critical mass, both in terms of public popularity and in terms of its artistic impact and the kind of persuasive nature the music held with its audience. That was the big fall of Led Zeppelin breaking through. They were the giant new rock band that fall. The concerts were moving from the psychedelic ballrooms of the Fillmores and the Grande ballrooms and those places across the country into a more formalized kind of concert business. All this stuff was galvanized by this Rolling Stones tour, which came along at such a perfect point and grabbed so much of the public's imagination and attention, it really kind of focused the whole world on rock music.
Yeah, and it does seem like they maybe had some sort of premonition that this tour would do exactly that, because they do have plans to film some of these shows for this Gimme Shelter documentary. When did those plans come to fruition exactly?
So I think the Stones really didn't know what they were doing. And when they came to the United States and spent a few weeks finishing their album before the tour started in Los Angeles, that's when they experienced the explosion of the rock scene in the United States. They'd been away for 3 years, and that was a big 3 years to be absent. So they showed up in Los Angeles, and they realized that not only were they on top of this scene, but the scene itself was just exploding beyond their imagination. And that's when the plans to make a movie started. It had been strictly a cash run. They were just going to go play a bunch of dates real quick and grab as much money as they can and go home. But once they got to Los Angeles, I think that the opportunities that were opening up for them became abundantly apparent. And that's when they started having these world-beating dreams like, let's make a movie, let's have a big free concert with 500,000 people, let's make sure the movie comes out before the Woodstock movie, which was part of their deal with the Maisels. A lot of ambitious plans.
Yeah, absolutely. And the most ambitious plan, just going back to the whole premise of this conversation, was this free show at the end. I believe it was a week after their final date in Florida that this show in Northern California takes place at the Altamont Speedway. Why was this even pursued to begin with? You know, I want to dig more into the PR aspect of this. Was their image tarnished on some level, or were they just looking for some goodwill?
Well, free concerts were very much something that was in the public imagination at that point. The whole hippie thing emanating out of San Francisco had really captured tremendous worldwide attention. The ethics and aesthetics of the hippies were very important in the rock scene. And the Stones found themselves being embraced by this so-called underground. So I think they wanted to encourage that association. They'd been rich, they'd been successful, they'd been a lot of things, but they'd never been so hip. And suddenly being hip seemed like an attractive proposition. It's hard to explain. But that being embraced, oh man, let's throw a groovy free concert. Then, on top of that, well, let's film it. We could have our own Woodstock. This is now falls into not just an happening, but something that has some career ambition underneath it. And it became part of a master plan. Rolling Stones were vying for leadership position in the rock scene with the Beatles, who were still in business at that point, but they were kind of falling apart. And here the Stones were putting out the greatest album of their career, Let It Bleed, and traveling through the States as, you know, triumphant conquering heroes. It was a moment for them to reach for the brass ring.
Yeah, absolutely. Let's talk about the Hells Angels. They have a history of involvement in the music scene on the West Coast at this time, particularly in LA and San Francisco. Where does the Hells Angels story begin in rock music at this time?
Well, you're right, Ryan. The Hells Angels were always part of the San Francisco music scene. There wasn't a concert in the park that didn't have a crowd of bikes around the stage. So the thing about the Hells Angels in Altamont is that when Sam Cutler in Rock Scully invited the Hells Angels to attend the concert, it was planned for Golden Gate Park, which would have meant that the San Francisco chapter of the Hells Angels would have had jurisdiction over the other chapters. And the San Francisco chapter was well known to the San Francisco rock bands. Those guys hung out at the shows backstage. They rode bikes with the roadies and some of the musicians in the bands. They did business together. They were altogether more wholly civilized group of Hells Angels than, say, the outliers in Oakland or San Jose. And it was the San Jose chapter, which was a brand new chapter. It started that summer after a turf war with a gang called the Gypsy Jokers, and the Angels had vanquished the Gypsy Jokers. They started this San Jose chapter with some former Gypsy Jokers and some South San Francisco Angels. And this was not a very civilized bunch. And those were the guys in front of the stage with the pool cues. The San Francisco chapter came in a bus, stood backstage. I mean, you know, they caused problems too, but they weren't the guys beating up the crowd.
Yeah, their reputation to me has always been sort of unfavorable as a group. But I guess back then it might have been different from location to location, like maybe they just weren't as notorious as a whole yet?
Well, actually, in 1966, the Attorney General of California had branded in a controversial report the Hells Angels as public enemy number one. So, no, they had a pretty high profile. But the Hells Angels were largely misunderstood. I mean, I don't want to sit here and defend the Hells Angels. They don't need my defense. But, you know, the Hells Angels at Altamont were the Hells Angels that we all knew. Some of them were really helpful. If you talk to the people on the film crew, they all really appreciated the Hells Angels. Each one of them was assigned to Hells Angels, a kind of guide and a protector, a security guy. Talked to the doctor that ran the tent backstage. He was very appreciative of the help he got from the Hells Angels that day. On the other hand, you know, musicians were beat up. Road crew was beat up. Some of the people who worked for the Dead were badly injured. It was a melee, and there was some very irresponsible, horrible behavior by people in Hells Angels colors. There were also people in Hells Angels colors who were perfectly helpful and as depressed and angry about what went on as anybody. So it's hard to make these sweeping statements about them. And for 45 years, accounts of the Altamont have always just referred to Hells Angels this, Hells Angels that, and pointed fingers at them. I don't see that. The Rolling Stones effectively shifted blame from themselves who are truly responsible for everything that took place, to, you know, a bunch of aberrant sort of outlaw motorcycle guys who were unfairly blamed. And by the way, none of them had names until my book, except Sonny Barger. Sonny got his name in it. But I mean, I made sure that these people were human beings and that they had names and we knew who they were. We knew who Paul Hibbets, known as Animal, the guy who beat up Marty Ballin wearing that dead coyote on his hat, or Terry the Tramp, the Grateful Dead's associate who walked around that day with a bullwhip and ended up committing suicide. He was so depressed about what happened. And then the Hells Angels are individuals, and they've been painted very improperly in accounts of the Altamont thing before.
Yeah, I was surprised to see that you did go to that length to reveal everyone involved in that day. Now, granted, you know, there were trials that came after this that had names involved as well. So they're in the public domain, so to speak, but nobody had really portrayed them in the way that you did to this point, and that's what I enjoyed about the book. You know, talking more about the cultural point of view here and the kind of the mood in the air at the time, you know, rock is popular, but so is LSD. And this is just a couple of years after the Summer of Love, and the whole acid movement is, for lack of a better term, it's mainstream now. And it was really present at Altamont the day of that show. What happened here? Why was there so much of it going around, and how did so much bad acid get into that crowd?
So yeah, drugs were a big part of what happened at Altamont. In 1969, we were 2 years from the Summer of Love, when LSD first emerged in the San Francisco underground in 64, 65, the people who manufactured it were zealots. They were missionaries, and they went to great lengths, the chemists, to see that the compounds were stable and pure. By 1969, it had devolved into a criminal enterprise, and a lot of the material that was out there was badly contaminated with things like strychnine, which is a poison, but it happens to make the LSD trip last a little longer, or methamphetamine, which overstimulates LSD users. And one of the symptoms of methamphetamine LSD use is people take their clothes off because the clothes are too confining. There was a lot of that at Altamont. The doctors, I spoke to three of the four psychiatrists who worked there at the so-called bummer tent. They were astonished by what they saw, the level of drug abuse and bad drugs, poisonous. So were the people on the rock bands. Jefferson Airplane road manager Bill Laudner, he told me he'd never seen Hell's Angels with so many drugs. And believe me, Bill had seen the Hell's Angels plenty of times. He was on the bus with the pranksters. And yeah, almost everybody that I spoke to that was on drugs that day, and that was a prevalent thing in rock concerts in 1969, reported a bad experience, because LSD and all psychedelics are highly affected by environment. And this was not a pleasant environment. It was unhappy. It was difficult. There was no water. There was no place to go to the bathroom. Everybody was crowded beyond belief. Nobody was in a good mood. It was cold. It was hot in the day, cold at night. And there were literally tens of thousands of people out there on bad drugs.
So we're at the day of the show now, and I want to lean on you here, and just, if you don't mind, just take us through the day of the show, the hours leading up to it, and then the actual bill itself, which was, hey, if you were there, you got a hell of a free concert. If you were miles away from the stage, you know, you probably had a great time. Because
people did have a good time, and especially if they were remote from the stage. The sound system wasn't all that effective, as you might imagine, and it was garbled, so they didn't necessarily understand what was going on stage or hear all the calls for medical help and stuff. But yeah, people did report, like, oh yeah, I had a groovy time, you know, me and my friends, we had a picnic up there. And the concert started about 12 o'clock with Santana, who were currently in the top 10 with their first album and just breaking out of San Francisco. They'd been the surprise hit act of the Woodstock Festival, but they were the new boys on the street, and they opened the show. That's when the beating started on stage during Santana's set. Hell's Angel chased some kid across the stage and beat him with a pool cue right in front of the keyboard player. Next up, Jefferson Airplane, who, of course, were in on the planning of this whole thing. They were out of town for most of it, so they really left it in the hands of the Grateful Dead organization. And that was marred by further violence when one of the Hells Angels beat up Marty Ballin, the lead singer of the Airplane, on stage during the set. And then a second time backstage afterwards. And then beat up the Grateful Dead's road crew chief, Rex Jackson. So the situation gone out of hand on stage to everybody's understanding by that time. The Flying Burrito Brothers, featuring Graham Parsons, who was a friend of Keith Richards, played. There were no incidents during that set, but Crosby, Stills, Nash & Young were the next act, and beatings continued, Crosby pleading with the audience to not fight, some Hell's Angel continually stabbing Steve Stills with a sharpened cycle spoke in the leg every time he stepped up to speak. They cut their set short after about a half hour and just hightailed it the hell out of there. At which point, the Grateful Dead were supposed to appear, but given what had happened over the day, the violence and all that, the Dead just decided not to. So for the next 2.5 hours, the audience sat there while the sun went down, the temperature dropped 20 degrees, the Oakland Hells Angels showed up and rode their bikes right through the center of the crowd to the stage. It was a very harrowing, intimidating situation, and after dark, the Rolling Stones came on.
Yeah, and there's a great anecdote here that as soon as the Stones get there, you know, they get off the helicopter, and Jagger gets punched in the face in the first, like, 2 minutes that he's there, right?
Yeah, that's in the movie. Yeah, they filmed that in the movie. It's in there. He just goes down, and security guards just grab this guy, you know?
Yeah. So the Stones come on, and are they aware of everything that's taken place there to this point?
So they're sequestered backstage in a trailer, and whatever they saw walking from the helicopter to the trailer when they arrived was limited to incidental things like, you know, this guy with a bloody eye, this, you know, that kind of stuff. But once in the trailer, then people visiting them tell them what's been going on. They were met the Angels, and the Angels acted as their security guards, took them into the area where they tuned up before the show, and then escorted them to the stage. Once they got to the stage, I mean, there was 200 people on the stage. There's barely any room for them to move, and the Hells Angels feel free to just walk around that stage anywhere they want. No, I don't think the Rolling Stones were used to that kind of interference with their performance. I think they were. And also, there were no spotlights. The spotlights never arrived. So the only lighting on the stage was 50,000 watts of backlighting, which means that they could see everything in the front of the stage instead of being blinded by spotlights. And as the set progressed and the beating started in front of them, it really was impossible for them to ignore. They were seeing this right in front of them and hearing the yells. On audio tapes taken by the board, at the end of songs, there's no applause, but you can hear people yelling. And you can hear them yelling all through the music.
Now, I've read in some other circles, and this is maybe a more conspiratorial circles that I'm talking about, but it is mentioned in the book. It's mentioned, you know, Mick Jagger said this many times, that every time they launch into Sympathy for the Devil, something weird happens. What do you attribute?
Oh, that's what Jagger said, not such bunk.
Okay.
I mean, oh, they were having trouble with the song. They had to stop it. You know, Cool It Keith will get him to stop. Brothers and sisters. And then he tries to laugh it off. And then they start Under My Thumb. And that's when, at the end of that song, is when, and that one gets broken up. They stop that and start it a second time. This is not in the movie. The movie's not a very accurate portrayal of what really went on. And at the end of that song is when Meredith Hunter tries to climb up on the stage and gets into the fracas with the Hell's Angels that results in him being stabbed and kicked to death. Right in front of them. Right where they could see it. And if they missed the attack, a couple of people in the crowd picked up Hunter's body and carried it up to the stage and put it on the lip of the stage. Now, they've always denied that they knew what was going on. But I talked to people on that stage. Everybody saw that body. It was put on the stage. The Hell's Angels swarmed over it, pushed it back off into somebody's arms who carried him backstage where he was pronounced dead. But everybody saw it. It was dropped right at Keith Richards' feet. So, you know, at that point, the concert fell apart. They didn't know what to do, and they'd lost complete control of the situation. And Hell's Angels are swarming over the stage, and people are coming out from backstage. And finally, Mick Taylor, the new Stone, he says, "Well, let's play the new one." And Mick Jagger says, "All right, let's do that." So they played Brown Sugar for the first time in this band's history. They'd never been played in public before. They'd recorded it earlier in the week in Muscle Shoals. And the concert came right back together. And at that point, the Stones just click into gear, and they just power on for another hour. Now, the movie would leave you the impression that, you know, the concert was over after Hunter was killed, but no, they're on stage for another hour. And let me tell you, I heard 16-track mixes done by Bob Matthews of the Grateful Dead that were recorded that day, and oh, did the Stones play great. Charlie Watts and Bill Wyman had everything locked down. Mick Taylor and Keith Richards, their guitars were grinding together like gears. And Jagger was singing with an intensity and sincerity you rarely hear him. None of that loopy characterizations that he often like lapses into, but really singing it like he means it. And you know, they were terrified. They were pumped full of adrenaline. They were scared for their lives, and they went to hide in the music. That's what musicians do. They just buried themselves in the music, and to me, that's kind of heroic.
Let's go back to the scene with Meredith Hunter real quick, if you don't mind. Could you just tell people, you know, like you mentioned, he had tried to get on stage during Sympathy for the Devil. Tell people, you know, what actually went down when he tried to do that and what happened afterwards.
Hunter was an 18-year-old black guy in a lime green suit with a combed out afro and just a pure offense on sight to the Hell's Angels. But he tried to climb on stage. One of the Hell's Angels pushed him back down. Hunter got right back up and got in the guy's face. And that's when he was attacked from behind by other Hell's Angels, who pulled him down and threw him around and knocked him back into the crowd. He pulled out a gun. And before anything else could happen, another Hell's Angel standing nearby named Alan Pissarro out of San Jose reached down in a pirouette and pulled a knife out of an ankle sheath, did a second pirouette, and jumped on Hunter's back, stabbing him in the neck. As they fell down, he stabbed Hunter four more times. The Hell's Angels surrounded them. Pissarro was separated, and the Hell's Angels kicked and stomped and stood on Hunter's body until, you know, they got tired of it, I guess, and a couple of guys in the crowd picked up his body and carried it to the stage. Then pushed back into the arms of a young intern who'd been going to the stage because they'd been calling for a doctor, and that guy carried Hunter's body by himself backstage. Says his arms hurt for a week afterwards, but he did it on sheer adrenaline. And Dr. Richard Fine, who was the head of medical, attended Hunter, who still had life signs, but they were thin, tried to arrange for helicopter transport. It was unavailable. The helicopter was reserved for the Rolling Stones, and he died before an ambulance came. In the movie, there's a very dramatic scene where Hunter's girlfriend, Patty Bredehoff, is sobbing, crying, and they move his dead body covered in a sheet on a gurney past her. And they cut from that to a shot of a helicopter taking off, just going up, just, you know, 10 seconds, 15 seconds, and then go back to the show. Hunter's body was never taken on a helicopter. It sat in the office at the Speedway for 2.5-3 hours until the Alameda County Coroner's Office showed up, deciding to wait for the traffic to die down. The idea that the filmmakers would include that helicopter shot is just a complete lie, and it just undermines the whole point of the movie, which everybody thinks is a very honest movie. It's not, and it wouldn't be. The Rolling Stones were 50% owners of that movie from the very beginning, so whatever the Maisels did, they did knowing that their partners were looking over their shoulders, and that helicopter shot's the key to that for me. It's just a complete lie.
Well, in the film, too, you watch the killing of Hunter unfold, and then it cuts to Mick Jagger sitting in a film production office somewhere, right?
Yeah, that was Charlotte Zwirin's idea. She was brought in by the Maisels to work on the film after they shot the concert, and she felt that they didn't really have an ending. So she filmed the Stones watching the footage. They showed the footage of the Hunter killing Mick and Mick Jagger and Charlie Watts, and she filmed it. And after the Lucas shot at the end of Altamont, they cut to Jagger looking at this and then end on a freeze frame of him getting up from the editing booth with this sort of aghast, shaken look on his face, as if to somehow absolve the Rolling Stones. It's a very strange ending and controversial. You know, Pauline Kael, the New Yorker film critic, took on Gimme Shelter, and she compared it to Leni Riefenstahl's Triumph of the Will, which is, of course, the famous propaganda piece for Hitler. Kind of a tough comparison for film, but, you know, she had a lot about that right. That movie is propaganda, and it's meant to absolve the Rolling Stones of guilt and responsibility in a heinous situation that they solely and completely created by themselves.
Yeah, that was kind of my point, was I was going to get your take on the purpose of even filming, you know, Jagger's reaction to watching this footage. It seemed like it was just sort of, again, a a good PR move by them.
Yeah, well, you know, we see Mick, oh, he cares. He feels bad. Look at him. We're going to freeze frame on his, you know, ashen, shocked face. Do we have sympathy for him now instead of Meredith Hunter or Meredith Hunter's mother or Patty Bredehoff, his girlfriend? No, yeah, we do. We leave the movie feeling sympathetic for Mick Jagger. We're feeling sympathy for the devil.
There you go, yeah. Let's talk about the aftermath of the event. I mean, obviously the Rolling Stones are still one of the biggest acts in the world, but what happened to their professional careers immediately after the Altamont show?
That tour of America lifted them to the highest ranks of the rock world and it expanded the rock world itself. I don't think Altamont, as much of a blemish as it may be on the Rolling Stones' career, had any deleterious effect. If anything, it kind of added to the that delicious evil image that they had courted for so long. Although after the Altamont, I don't think the Rolling Stones were ever the same. I don't think they were ever the same ferocious, fierce rock band, and they certainly sort of avoided courting those kind of dark images that they had done so much before. I don't think that their work after Altamont measures up to the work before. To me, the bell curve of the Rolling Stones music is Let It Bleed, and the three or four tracks that they recorded before Altamont and Muscle Shoals that are on Sticky Fingers. But and the Rolling Stones went on to become bigger, more successful. They rode the entire wave of rock's worldwide popularity. And amazingly enough, are 50 years plus still functioning at the top of their abilities. They're an extraordinary rock band.
The Altamont show affected the Grateful Dead in a bit of a different way. What happened with them?
Oh, the Grateful Dead hated themselves after that. It was just a disastrous, dark time for them. They were all arrested in New Orleans a month later. That meant that a lot of problems. Their manager disappeared with all their money that month, and they were broke. I mean, it was just a very, very difficult time for them. And they emerged in the studio in February, 2 months later, in 5 days, cutting Working Man's Dead. Now, obviously, a lot of those songs have been in the works for, since the previous June. But there's something so warm and, you know, it was a sanctuary, a safe place for them to do that kind of warm, acoustic, open, country-ish kind of music instead of the, you know, electro blues acid jams that they'd specialized in. And Working Man's Dead, I think, was this safe place where they retreated. Obviously, Robert Hunter, the band's lyricist, felt very strongly about Altamont. That was his song, New Speedway Boogie, that really is, his commentary on the whole thing. And they were playing that song in their set within 3 weeks after Altamont.
How about the effect the event had on the Hell's Angels as a group?
Oh, now it's ruined the Hell's Angels because in as much of the focus of the public hostility and law enforcement priorities as they'd been before, now they were really public enemy number one. And they'd gained a kind of notoriety that isn't good if you're in the outlaw motorcycle gang business. Sonny Barger was in prison inside like 3 years. A bunch of guys were either dead or in witness protection program very soon after that. By the end of the 70s, the federal government had just destroyed the Hell's Angels with RICO prosecutions for gang-related crimes. But yeah, no, here's something for you, Ryan. How many Hell's Angels do you think were at Altamont?
Well, 40. Yeah, I was going to say there's reports that there were several hundred, but you say that there's only 40.
There weren't even several hundred Hell's Angels in the state of California at that point. Reports greatly exaggerate their size and their abilities. But yes, there were the police estimated there were about 40 Hells Angels there.
Let's talk about the trial of Alan Passaro. It took police a little while to track down, just based on the nature of the event itself, who might have killed Meredith Hunter. But once they did, they put Alan Passaro on trial. What happened there?
Passaro was found not guilty. He had a brilliant defense attorney, an African-American attorney named George Walker, who was a very prominent San Francisco criminal attorney and brilliantly, long before Johnny Cochran, played the race card in his defense of Pissarri, made sure he got an all-white jury, which in Oakland, California isn't easy to do. And then he proceeded to pick apart the prosecution's case. All their witnesses were on drugs. All of them were hippies and not trustworthy. And by the way, that film that they keep showing of Alan Pissarro stabbing Meredith Hunter shows Meredith Hunter with a gun in his hand. So Pissarro was acquitted.
You know, there's never any real justice for Hunter's family. I believe his mom files a lawsuit against several of the parties involved, but really only comes out with, I believe, $10,000 from the whole deal. So I don't know if that's justice, but I guess it's something.
Meredith Hunter's mother is a schizophrenic prostitute who never had a shot in life. Meredith was the son of her, and he never had a chance. He went to jail the first time when he was 11 years old. His sister, his older sister, who pretty much raised him, doesn't even remember what for. The charge on his record says willful disobedience. What sort of jive charge that is, I don't know. But he spent his whole teenage years in and out of California Youth Authority on just nothing charges, burglary, grand theft auto, probation violations. And had only been out since May of 69 when he, you know, showed up at Altamont. His mother, I mean, she's still alive. She was just one of these, you know, pathetic people that never had a real life. And her oldest daughter was the product of rape. I interviewed Dixie for the book, and it's just a terrible story. And you know, I want to remind you, you know, those of us who know Meredith Hunter, who are white, we see him in a different way than black people do. And black people in this country, they know who Meredith Hunter is. They know he's the guy that was in the wrong place at the wrong time, going somewhere he shouldn't have gone, because he was killed by a Hell's Angel amongst a bunch of hippies at the height of the Love era while the Rolling Stones played. You know, I mean, this is just, it resonates in an entirely different way for black Americans than it does whites.
Yeah, let's talk about the aftermath for the hippie movement, the hippie generation. How did the Altamont event affect that?
It gave lie to the whole brotherhood of races and the nonviolence of Woodstock. It made the hippie movement have to confront itself honestly in ways that, you know, pretty much sort of spelled its slow dissolution, although it's still with us today. But there were so many subterranean forces converging that day, both political, social, musical, etc., that it forces a lot of consideration of all that mythology that was being developed around hippies since the Summer of Love. And, you know, that's something that's easier to go into in a book than it is in a podcast.
Well, sure, yeah, but I'd like to speculate to end our conversation here, if you don't mind, on just a couple of points that tie into that. The first point that I want to touch on is Sam Cutler wrote in his autobiography that he thinks maybe the mafia and law enforcement intentionally spread the bad acid and removed themselves from any responsible policing and possibly sent Meredith Hunter there to cause mayhem. I don't know how that would have went down. But what do you make of Sam's claim there?
I spent a lot of time with Sam working on this book, and he's a lovely, charming old rogue. And he's one of those people that is conspiracy theory minded. First of all, he credits the federal government with more competence than I do with that. But second of all, I would say I pulled the Altamont FBI file under a Freedom of Information Act request, and it's not very long, and it's so clueless, it's just ridiculous. Something like Altamont in 1969 was beyond the understanding of the FBI. It just didn't register with them in any way that was meaningful. So, you know, like I say, yeah, sure, Sam. He has some strange theory about LSD being manufactured by the federal government, too.
Well, yeah, I've heard that, you know, and that ties back into a couple of points that I could make about this. You know, I don't know if I want to go down that whole conspiratorial rabbit hole right now, but there is some interesting threads. You know, there's ties to the Laurel Canyon community here, which, are you familiar with Dave McGowan's work here?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, what do you make of the Laurel Canyon scene and its connection to the Rolling Stones and some of the other acts that came out of that, you know, the Doors and Grand Parsons,
I believe. Their connection with Laurel Canyon was renting Stephen Stills' house while they were working on Let It Bleed in October of 69.
Right.
Look, you know, here's the deal. Altamont was just a Rock Scully fantasy, and somebody believed he knew what he was talking about, Keith Richards. I understand this so well. I knew Rock. Rock was a wonderful guy, but he was a hippie. He was a took a lot of LSD and believed in the cosmic giggle. So, you know, when he left Keith Richards' house, having suggested this whole thing, I'm not sure if he even thought of it again until Keith called him. But it's in complete keeping with the kind of sort of misadventure that can follow that kind of caprice if it's taken seriously. I don't have any problem understanding how Altamont happened, and I don't think anybody who read my book will either.
I just want to tie up, you know, I mentioned I want to talk about Sonny Barger and Melvin Belli just real quick and this just kind of speculate on them. But Barger, it appears, was an informant for the Department of the ATF. Are you aware of that?
That's a controversial aspect of Barger's life. Yeah, I've heard that. It's a Whitey Bulger kind of deal. I'm sure he was playing those guys off against his enemies.
Right. Yeah. Well, you know, the Hells Angels did have a unique relationship with law enfortment at the time. You know, they would confiscate
guns.
Hunter's
gun back to the cops.
Yeah, and they would do that for a lot of different things. They would take guns from people and hand them over to the police, right? Like, just
they,
in general.
They had a liaison with a San Francisco police officer who would talk to them off record. And they had similar relationships with the Oakland police. I think that police have those kind of channels, back channels into the criminal underworlds everywhere. They just don't like to talk about it.
Mm-hmm. And then, you know, I wanted to talk about Belli because just after I finished the book and as I was preparing for this, I came across a really interesting nugget that ties him to the CIA. Are you aware of that claim as well?
Belli?
Yeah.
Oh, man. Belli, I have no problem believing that. He was a crazy, old-fashioned, Wild West guy. He dressed like a character, a lawyer out of Dickens. He had a street-level office with a big picture window so people could walk by on the street and just watch him practice law. He was a rootin' tootin' Wild West lawyer and tremendous legal mind.
And he had some pretty high-profile clients, too. Jack Ruby was a client
yep.
of his.
Yep.
Sirhan Sirhan.
Yep.
Yeah, he's involved in some really shady trials and tribulations here, so the fact that he's maybe tied to some sort of government intelligence would not surprise me at all. But I was just curious if you were aware of those connections or rumors, because that does kind of tie into Sam's claim about, you know, maybe there was
a little more going on with the Stones. He was only there because he could get on TV. He went to the concert and was appalled. He was so out of his element. I don't know that he ever met the Stones.
Yeah,
his association with this was very slight and very brief and only commemorated by that scene in the movie. There were other people who were much more involved and much more important to that, you know, didn't get in the movie.
Last question for you then. What's the historical impact in general of this entire Altamont incident?
Well, you know, people like to say it was the end of the 60s because it was December 1969, and it certainly represented a great loss of innocence on the part of the counterculture. But to me, the 60s didn't end until the war was over in 75. I'm not sure that Altamont was really the end of anything. It wasn't the end of the counterculture. It wasn't the end of the underground. It wasn't the end of free concerts in open meadows. It just was a catastrophic event that was born out of a volatile cocktail of innocence and greed. And, you know, stands on the otherwise rather glorious history of rock like a smear, like, you know, a Lusitania or a Hindenburg, some, you know, man-made disaster.
Absolutely, man. And you document it very well from start to finish. And there's just a lot more detail that we just couldn't cover in an hour-long conversation here. But Joel, I appreciate your time. If people want to keep up with you and your work, where can they find you online?
There's a joelselvin.com. I'm on Facebook and in your local bookstore. Thanks for having me, Ryan.
All right, there you have it. My thanks again to Joel Selvin. Check him out at joelselvin.com or at your local bookstore. There's also a link to the Altamont book in the show notes if you're interested. You know, I try not to see the world through a conspiratorial lens. Well, just kidding. I'm quite sure there is some fuckery afoot. To what level, no one really knows, but I do enjoy me a good conspiracy theory, and if you may have noticed, I was really trying to get Joel to speculate towards the end there, because there is quite a bit of evidence out there surrounding military intelligence and their connection to the hippie movement and the greater 1960s drug culture. I mentioned Dave McGowan's work. His book, Weird Scenes Inside the Canyon, exposes a lot of the most famous rock bands of that era as maybe nothing more than covert military intelligence operations, but that's a topic for a whole other episode, and it's one you'll get from me sooner rather than later. As things relate directly to Joel's telling of the Altamont story, there were a few nuggets in his book that did raise an eyebrow for me when I was reading through it, and I wonder if any dots connect to perhaps a more nefarious plot on the day of the Altamont show. Like I said, these are just passing mentions in Joel's book, but the first one that caught my eye was that Mick Jagger attended the London School of Economics, or the LSE for short. Now, the LSE has a reputation for being, well, to put it bluntly, they have a reputation for being a bunch of socialists. The school was co-founded by noted socialist George Bernard Shaw, a Nobel-winning playwright and Oscar-winning screenwriter. Shaw was part of a group called the Fabian Society, which is a public socialist organization that essentially wants to infiltrate democracies, such as America's, perhaps? And gradually alter those democracies, those political and economic systems, to better fit their socialist agenda. So Shaw and the Fabian Society create this school, the LSE, and in 1963, Mick Jagger strolls into the class ranks of the LSE, despite the fact that the Rolling Stones had just signed a record deal. Their first album came out in 1964, so they're gearing up for this. Now, what follows is very anecdotal evidence, so take this with a grain of salt. And I pick up this anecdote from a lady named Sally Stevens, whose mother was apparently engaged to one of the members of the LSE's Board of Governors, a guy named Derek Bell. Sally relates some interesting details on Derek's career path, which, apart from sitting on the LSE's Board of Governors, also included some time working as a chief buyer for the British Aircraft Corporation, which sold military aircraft to governments around the world. They're no longer in business, but think of them back then as more like a Lockheed or a Boeing now. That was the British Aircraft Corporation. So this Derek Bell leaves this job with the BAC to take his seat on the Board of Governors at the LSE. So an interesting career path from that line of business to sitting on the board of a socialist outfit masquerading as a university of some sort. That's the setup to this nugget here. Sally Stevens writes this, quote, "One evening, we're having dinner. Derek had been up to town, as we used to refer to London, on some business or other. He fixes me with his eye and asks, 'You know about this sort of thing. Have you heard of a band called the Rolling Stones?' Sally says, 'Yes, why?' And then she says this, 'From what I recall of the ensuing conversation, during their first year, students at LSE were allowed to write a grant proposal for project funding from LSE. According to Derek, Mick had written a good grant proposal using the Rolling Stones as his business model and asking for financial aid to buy equipment so they could improve their stage sound. Of course, not one member of the board, including Derek, had much of an idea about the financial soundness of rock music, though obviously it was becoming an economic powerhouse and they'd sort of heard of the Beatles. But when it came to the niceties of the business, LSE needed an expert opinion. In this case, me, Sally Stevens. So Derek and the board wanted to know if the Stones had any future, and I, Sally, was able to say, I thought so, based on what I was seeing. And I was asked, would they be a good risk? Yeah. So Mick got some grant money from LSE, which he bought gear with, after which he gave LSE the salute and took off for the sky." End quote. Now, I know that grants are not meant to be paid back, but I think one may be able to see the dots that I'm trying to connect here. A socialist school hands out money to a young kid pursuing his dreams, and that kid goes on to be one of the biggest rock stars of the decade. You have a tumultuous climate in America at this time as well. A better time to infiltrate a democracy through its culture than a time where it's already shifting and changing and trying to find stability. And if you charted the course of American culture and politics since the 60s, I think the phrase increasingly socialist may be an apt way to describe that course. But again, very anecdotal. One other anecdote from Joel's book. The Stones arrive in Hollywood in October 1969 in preparation for this tour. The place they're using for their business headquarters is a rental mansion in Hollywood Hills, once owned by the DuPont family. Major red flag there. Now, while that was their business headquarters, they're actually staying at a house in Laurel Canyon. I believe it was Stephen Still's house. That Laurel Canyon connection, that CIA deep state military intelligence connection, again, just knowing the work of Dave McGowan, that raised a red flag for me too. You add all these things to the other things that we did mention, the fact that this John James character got involved and played a prominent role in this tour. If you remember, he was the guy who told Chrysler he worked for the Stones and told the Stones he worked for Chrysler and who had some organized crime and police connections. And then Melvin Belli, the lawyer with possible CIA ties who represented Jack Ruby and Sirhan Sirhan. And Sonny Barger, the Hell's Angels leader who may have been an informant for the ATF. A lot of potential for what I like to call high fuckery around this event. Doesn't mean the Stones were privy to it, but I can't help but wonder if Altamont was doomed from the start. In fact, astrologically speaking, it was. As Joel writes in his book, even before the music started that day, omens could be found if one wanted to see them. Astrologers wondered why the producers had not charted the stars for the occasion. The Woodstock producers consulted astrologers before selecting the dates. On Saturday, December 6th, the moon was in Scorpio. The forecast was heavy days, evil tidings, acts of violence. From the beginning, there was blood on the ground. And that does it for this episode. If you don't mind, please do drop the show a good rating on iTunes. Helps out in search results and gets the show noticed by a bit more people. And of course, hit the show notes for links to things mentioned during the show and for ways to keep up with the show on social media. And that's it for me. You've been listening to OCCULTURE. I am Ryan Peverly, reminding you to love yourself, think for yourself, and question authority. I'll watch with glee while you kings and queens for pretend decades for the gods they made. I'll shout it out, who killed the Kennedys? When after all, it was you and me. Let me please introduce myself. I'm a man of wealth and taste. I lay traps for troubadours who get killed before they reach Bombay.
Please rewind this cassette.